Okay, I realize at the end of my critique on the Great Pie Conspiracy, I challenged my viewers to look over Mark Wollum's two articles and find the ever-so-slight flaws for yourselves. Problem is, some people are not able to think for themselves and need to be led around by the ring in their nose. That's one reason why I'm against body piercings. YouTube user See No One, for example, had a hard time following along while I explained that you can't just claim two right triangles are similar. You have to prove they're similar in some way before you start using properties that are only true for similar triangles. Similarly, you have to prove that two triangles are Kepler triangles before using properties that are true only for Kepler triangles. And you can't prove you have a Kepler triangle by using a relationship that is true for more triangles than just Kepler triangles. And you certainly can't prove a triangle is a Kepler triangle or that you have two similar triangles if you have to change a constant value to do it. I even demonstrated, using triangles that are clearly not Kepler triangles, that you can force any triangle to pass Wollum's side length test by changing known constants. But somehow, See No One didn't get it. So I'm guessing that he won't get this video either. In the Great Pie Conspiracy Part 2, Wollum starts with two new triangles, both with a hypotenuse of 16 over pi. Redrawing his triangles in a more standard form, you can make a good guess at what Wollum's intent will be. He will probably want to make these two triangles congruent, meaning equal sides and angles. Of course, using what little information is available, just two different sides for each triangle, you can easily show that the corresponding angles of these two triangles are not equal. Therefore, they cannot be congruent or even similar. Oops. I think we've lost poor C No One already. Also, using the known value of pi, we can calculate the missing sides and show that they are not the same, further proving the two triangles are not congruent. But the short side of triangle 1 is close to pi, and the long side of triangle 2 is close to 4, so they look nearly the same. Then, if you assume that the ratios of the known sides are equal to the ratios of a Kepler triangle, you come up with the relationship that Wollum wants us to believe. Problem is, Wollum never establishes that he has two congruent Kepler triangles before arriving at his new value of pi. And the only way he could do that is by calculating the ratios, which only proves neither triangle is a Kepler triangle. Now, folks who suffer from conspiracy mentality don't understand the necessity of starting with known facts before venturing into the unknown. They make up their own stories as they go along and often use logic that's not very logical. See, No One, for example, thinks it's a fallacy to use the traditional value of pi in the calculations I've just shown, but it's not a fallacy to use Wollum's proposed pi. Of course, you can't have it both ways. If you can't use one value, you can't use the other. You need to find another approach to demonstrate that the two triangles are similar or congruent or Keplerian that doesn't use the value pi to do so. Wollum failed to do this beforehand. I'm going to skip Wollum's figures 2 through 6 that are just background that we covered in part 1 and jump right into where Wollum begins his proof for his new value of pi. Now, if this first equation makes about as much sense as 5 times 8 over 5 times 3 over 8 equals 3, don't worry. There's nothing wrong with you. It didn't make sense to me either. All Wollum is doing is finding a path to what he calls equation 1, a over c equals the perimeter of square B over the circumference of circle C. Now, I would have taken a more direct approach using the A over B identity Wollum gives us in his figure 7. But in this situation, I suppose it's not the journey that's important, just the destination. Here, Wollum does some real hocus pocus. In step 2, he multiplies each side by pi squared over 16. That's okay. We can multiply each side of an equation by the same constant, or variable for that matter, and it doesn't change the equation. This constant simply gets sucked into the variable ratio on the right, but in step 5, he commits an inappropriate substitution that would make Mr. Sproul cringe. Wollum notes that we know b over a equals pi over 4, right? Then it follows that b squared over a squared equals pi squared over 16, right? So anywhere we see pi squared over 16, we should be able to substitute b squared over a squared, right? Wrong. You can't just go around willy-nilly changing constants into variables or ratios of variables for that matter, especially if you don't know where those constants have been. You might as well pick up candy off the sidewalk and eat it. Constants are fixed values. You can't change constants. They are specific. Variables represent values that can change. They are not specific. When you know what a variable's value is, you can replace that variable with its value, but not the other way around. Not without suffering consequences. In this case, Wollum essentially multiplied one side of the equation by a variable expression and the other by its value in step 2. Not apropos, but the only way to force equation 2 out of this mess. Actually, I couldn't figure out any way to get to equation 2 without replacing 4th B somewhere. So Wollum's statement that equation 2 is valid for a set of triangles which all have the same interior angles is incorrect. The equation is only valid when B equals 4, because that's the condition he locked us into when he made the inappropriate substitution. But of course, Wollum knew that. Now, take a close look at equation 2. Deja vu all over again, right? Where have we seen something like this before? Well, back in part 1, and repeated in figure 6 in part 2, Wollum gives us the special property for Kepler triangles, A times C equals B squared. Well, that would make B squared over AC equal to 1, wouldn't it? It would then directly follow that the length of side C is equal to pi. This would be true if triangle 1 was a Kepler triangle, which Wollum never proves beforehand. Wollum takes another circuitous route around triangle 1 to get his equation 3. In the process, he makes a second inappropriate substitution, replacing b squared with 4 times b in step 2. Oh, the humanity! Surprisingly, you can get directly to equation 3 from a known identity. A, the hypotenuse, equals 16 over pi, without any inappropriate substitutions whatsoever. So, equation 3 is actually a valid equation, not only for triangle 1, but for any triangle that has a hypotenuse equal to 16 over pi. Yes, totally valid. There's absolutely nothing wrong with equation 3. Unfortunately for the pi conspirators, equation 3 is a balanced equation, meaning both sides evaluate to the same value for the real value of pi, 3.14159 whatever. And coincidentally, because b equals 4 in triangle 1, equation 2 is also necessarily a balanced equation using the real value of pi. How about that? Actually, truth be known, both equations are balanced for pi equal to any positive number less than 4, which includes the real value of pi, and also Wollum's new pi. I'll leave it as an exercise for the casual student to show why that is, but since equation 3 is valid for any triangle with a hypotenuse of 16 over pi, then it's balanced over the same range of pi when applied to triangle 2. How convenient, huh? Of course, for triangle 2, equation 2 will only have one solution for pi, which will result in the required prerequisite, b equals 4. Can you guess what that value might be? Nevertheless, you can see where Wollum could apply his equation 3 to triangle 2 and get, not surprisingly, b equals 4, regardless of what value he assigns to pi, because pi literally drops out of the equation. But, of course, Wollum knew that. Now, for the life of me, I couldn't understand the point behind Wollum's sidebar on similar triangles. He might just as well have gone, "Look, squirrel!" and then continued on with his analysis. Without getting sucked into the details, his conclusion is that equation 2 can only be valid for right triangles with specific internal angles, where the ratio of the hypotenuse over the long side equals 4 over pi. And the same goes for equation 3. Of course, the angles do change if you change the value of pi. With respect to triangle 1, if you let the value of pi increase, the length of the hypotenuse and the short side both decrease in length, and the smaller acute angle also decreases. Likewise, for triangle 2, as pi increases, the hypotenuse and the long side both decrease in length, while the short side and the smaller acute angle both increase. The angles change because the lengths of the sides change when you change the value of pi. Bottom line, Equations 2 and 3 are linked to the hypotenuse of the triangle and have nothing to do with any congruent angles. But, of course, Wollum knew that. Wollum then performs another bizarre conversion to show you can derive his equation 3 directly from triangle 2. Of course, his approach requires yet another inappropriate substitution, swapping f for pi in step 5. As if that would surprise anyone at this point. But we already know that equation 3 is valid for any triangle with a hypotenuse equal to 16 over pi. Triangle 2 is simply one of many. Yet, somehow, Wollum concludes that since he could derive equation 3 from both triangles, then, look, squirrel! Both triangles must have the same interior angles, and therefore, they must be congruent. Surprise, surprise, surprise! Then, for his coup de grace, Wollum shows that for his hybrid triangle, the ratio of the hypotenuse over the long side equals the ratio of the long side over the short side, and therefore, look, squirrel! This must be a Kepler triangle, and therefore, pi must be equal to 4 over the square root of the golden ratio. Bet you didn't see that coming. Of course, equal ratios, like Wollum's special property, don't necessarily mean you have a Kepler triangle. In fact, it doesn't even mean you have a right triangle at all. And simply finding a solution to a quartic equation, which, déjà vu, we solved in part 1, doesn't mean the solution is some profound revelation of an ancient conspiracy to hide the true value of pi from the general public. It just means that people who have a natural tendency toward confirmation bias will ignore inconvenient facts. They see evidence where there is none and think it supports their preconceived conclusions even if the evidence contradicts their beliefs. Often they project themselves on others, pushing their own cognitive biases onto other people. They miss the relationship between words like coincide and coincidence and make up new meanings to words like derive and derivation to fit their argument. And no matter how good a job you do to prove them wrong, no matter how clear and rational your argument, they never seem to understand. But it's not their fault. They have a mental block, some kind of defensive mechanism that protects their own confidence in their fragile convictions. At this point, I don't know who's more insane. The people who clearly suffer from psychological disorders that make them vulnerable to believing junk science and conspiracies, or the people who argue with them. Tough call, that one.